Yeah, you are welcome, viewers, for our first discussion. But before we start, let's have a short prayer. Let's have a short prayer. Lord, our Father, we thank you for the day. We pray that you guide us as we discuss today. As we are discussed in the WhatsApp group that we shall start with, a topic called lymphatic system. So now, as we are discussing the lymphatic system, you will find that this is a very important system in the human body, and therefore a person must understand this system very well. So when someone talks about lymphatic system, what does he mean? Lymphatic system, the definition of the lymphatic system, is the body's defense system.
That involves?
It's the body's defense system. It's the body's defense system that
involves lymph vessels.
That involves lymph vessels.
And lymph itself.
That involves lymph vessels and
lymph itself,
whereby the lymph vessels transported
from the tissue tree,
whereby lymph vessels transport lymph from
the tissue field to the blood streams.
You will find that the lymphatic system is the body's defense system that transports lymph from lymph vessels to that is the body's defense system that transports lymph from the tissue fluid into what we call the bloody streams. I want you to keep on sharing, invite friends, copy the link and put it in WhatsApp so that people can be watching. So, this is the definition of lymphatic system. It is the body's defense system that transports lymph, from tissue fluid into bloody streams. What could be the functions of this system? The functions of the lymphatic system, the LS system. The first function is very simple. I'll start with what we call defense and immunity. When someone talks about defense and immunity, roughly, you must see that with the type of immunity, as I was discussing for you immunity in class, we talked about what we call the cell-mediated type of immunity. So this is going to force me first to do a recap of some part of immunity. When someone talks about immunity, what do they mean? Immunity is the body's defense, is the ability of a body to resist diseases. And we find that immune system is that system that is composed of a network of cells and the chemicals that work together by producing antibodies that will always help the body to fight against diseases. Immunity is divided into majorly two classes. What you call the innate and the adaptive. With the innate type of immunity, this is non-specific in nature. The other name for innate is non-specific, while adaptive is
specific.
So you will find that with innate type of immunity, this is the type of immunity where there is use of there is use of natural mechanism. These natural mechanisms are divided into two classes. That is what you call the physical, stroke mechanical, and what you call the chemical. You must all appreciate and get to know that with the physical are those mechanisms that we can see with our naked eyes. You'll find that with the physical, with the physical mechanism, I'll start with what we call the skin. Our skin, the human skin, is a physical type of, actually is a physical mechanism of innate immunity. How does it help in immunity? It has got roughly 3 ways how it helps in immunity. You'll find that with the skin, it has got nomophorola on it. Nomophorola, you all know the meaning of the word nomophorola. Nomophorola, this nomophorola helps to occupy the space that would have been for the harmful bacteria. Therefore, in so doing, it is preventing the body from acquiring what? From acquiring harm or acquiring infections. The nomophorola. We have that the skin protects the underlying surfaces from damage. We must all appreciate that the skin is a characterized type of epithelium, which is consisting of dead cells. Therefore, these dead cells help to protect the underlying surfaces. Further, the skin consists of what we call the sebaceous glands. These sebaceous glands are very important in keeping the skin oily or moist, so that it prevents mechanical damage. If I further continue with another physical mechanism that can be seen with our eyes, we have what we call the mucous membrane. We must know that the mucous membrane is found in the nose. So with the mucous membrane, it is this membrane that will always separate for us what we call mucus, which mucus will always trap dust as it enters the nose, with the help of the cilia, of course. So we have a lot of other physical mechanisms that can be seen. But we are just doing revision and trying to remind those who are not covered the lymphatic system. If I further continue with the chemical, with this chemical. The chemical, first of all, allow me to tell you that chemical, the body is composed of different chemicals. And with the chemical immunity, it is greatly relying on what we call the HCl in the stomach. This HCl helps to kill microorganisms that would happen under the stomach. Anything you eat, when it is composed of bacteria, any microorganism, the HCl will try to fight it. And actually, you must appreciate that with the innate type of immunity, on and specific, this type works with the vaccine or without being vaccinated. If you are breastfed or not, you'll find that a person who was not breastfed, who was not vaccinated, the HCl will be secreted by the gastric juice, which gastric juice is helped by what we call the parietal cells, right? So with the HCl, I think we are there with the HCl. HCl kills microorganisms in the stomach. If I further continue, we have what we call the tear gland. The tear gland contains what we call lysosomes. Lysosomes are very important elements that help to kill microorganisms on the skin, on the eyes. This tear gland consists of chemicals. It is the same thing as when you taste tear, you find that it contains of salt. But don't dare get salt and put in water and wash your eyes, because you will get problems for nothing. These lysosomes know what amount of salt must be kept in the tears. If I further continue, there is what we call, because I'm done with the HCl, hope you're all there, I'm done with the tear gland. We also have what we call the lactic acid, that is produced by the lactobacillus. The lactic acid, this one is found in the vaginal canal of ladies, and therefore this helps to fight diseases that would surface into the vaginal canal. Hope you are there with the lactic acid. So that is the innate type of immunity. Allow me rub it off and also do some adaptive. I'm interested a lot with the adaptive. It is with the adaptive where I'm interested a lot. So I want you to keep on sharing. Then you try to share and also invite more people to come online. We are going to do adaptive. Immunity. So with the adaptive type of immunity, it is where we shall study the body uses both the antigen and antibodies in fighting against diseases. So we are already online. I expect to see people coming online so that they can engage into the discussion. With the adaptive immunity, here. Adaptive immunity is where the body uses both antibodies and antigens in fighting against diseases. I want you to come online, keep on coming online so that we can discuss. We delayed by some few minutes because of the network, but I hope we shall be there. We shall cover that thing up. So me, I'm already online to discuss for you adaptive immunity now. That is where so far I've reached. With the adaptive immunity, it is where the body uses antibodies and antigens in fighting diseases. So with this adaptive, you will see that it is divided into two major classes. Adaptive immunity is divided into major classes. That is where we have what we call the seromediated. And the hormonal. With the cell-mediated, it is my major part here, as I discussed for defense and the immunity. When someone talks about cell-mediated, roughly, this cell-mediated is where only we see the cells. It is actually a cell-controlled type of immunity, where the cells will always fight against diseases by themselves without the help of antibodies and whatsoever. And this is helped by what we call the lymphatic system. So this is how important the lymphatic system is. So under cell-mediated, remember we have what we call bony marrow. This bony marrow are very important in producing, first of all, red blood cells. Actually, all cells are produced by the bony marrows. And they're also important in producing what called the lymphocytes. These lymphocytes are very important. Are very, very important because they help us stimulate the production of what we call the T cells. The T cells. These T cells are divided into two, what you call the T4 and the T8. So these T cells will help us stimulate the production of what we call the beta cells. These beta cells help us in producing for us what we call the antibodies. Now, look at this. This is how the lymphatic system will fight the disease. How? Tell a scenario that this is our T cell composed of the T4. So our microorganism, let us say it is a bacteria with an irregular process. Irregular process means irregular shape, comes and attacks the cell. As it attacks the cell, it is here we shall see the T4 cell come and engulf the bacteria into the cell. As it engulfs it, it will bring the antibodies that are produced by beta cells and they destroy the bacteria. But as they destroy the bacteria, this reaction tends to be a strong reaction that can cause harm. And always cause harm to the human body. That is where we shall see the T8 coming to suppress or compress the reaction so that it does not cause harm to the body. So here we must appreciate that after all that process is done, by process by which the cell has engulfed the bacteria is what we call the phagocytosis. So what we call the phagocytosis. With the phagocytosis, this is a process by which a cell feeds on large particles by engulfing it. It is what we call the cell eating. Feeds on the large particles by engulfing it. So the opposite of phagocytosis is what we call the pinocytosis, where the cell feeds on small particles. And roughly these are usually liquids, by still also allowing them diffusing to the cell. That's what we call cell drinking. So I hope after the microorganism has been killed, we shall see that this cell which is now already destroyed will be taken out of the cell by a process called exocytosis. So therefore, exocytosis is the process by which waste matters are taken out of the cell. This is how actually the lymphatic system carries out the defense and immunity. Hope we are there. You know, it seems to be challenging this discussing for class, which is not seeing you, but it's just listening and watching you online. But hope we need to want all of us need to want the COVID come. So with now the humoral, which is another type of adaptive immunity, I can also give a hint. Humoral. So with the humoral type of immunity, you will find that it is first of all, it is where there is actually with the humoral type of immunity, where there is use of antibodies. So you will find that it is divided into two classes, active and passive immunity. With the active immunity, it is further divided into two. So we shall start in the active immunity. It is where a person has to first suffer from infection. So that antibodies are able to be stimulated. Are we there? So I expect you to be commenting with questions. So I'll be getting the questions and answer them on spot before. So it is the active transport also divided into natural and the artificial. Still, with the passive, this is the type of immunity which is just passed on. It is where the body receives already maybe antibodies. Here, the body receives its own antibodies. It is also divided into natural and the artificial. So we have the natural active immunity, the artificial active immunity, natural passive immunity, and artificial passive immunity. You must all appreciate with the natural active immunity, it is where a body has to first suffer. What do I mean? Take a scenario. People are suffering from flu these days. People are suffering from flu. So what we do, we shall always treat them against the flu. And after treating them against the flu, the antibodies that would have helped a person to heal against the flu will be kept in the body. Those excess antibodies will be kept in the body and will be used in the future if the flu surfaces again. You will find that now, in that future, the body will act naturally by its own. It will just remember this adaptive is also called memory immunity. It has the ability to keep memory. So here, the antibodies that would have been kept will be used in the future to fight against diseases. So if I further continue, we have what we call artificial active immunity. This is where we use the vaccines. Long ago, when we are still young, you will find that we were vaccinated against immunizable diseases. The polio, the measles, the tetanus, the whooping cough, and all other immunizable diseases. So you will find that here, with the presence of vaccines, you will see that the vaccines actually produced antibodies. Produced antibodies, and these antibodies were kept in the body. But up to now, the disease might have attacked you, but you didn't even realize, because the antibodies fought it. And then I found one. So because of the, after actually, but the problem with this, but it acts at a slow pace, you get. So we shall also discuss some advantages and disadvantages of all these types. So if I further continue with the natural passive immunity, which is just passed on. So with the natural, what is passed on? We shall start in the breast milk. So through breastfeeding. The breastfeeding helps us. Actually, remember, we must appreciate that all of us are supposed to be breastfed, so that we can be able to fight against diseases. So we find that in the breast milk, it is that type of milk which contains of all nutrients that will help to boost the immunity of a younger kid. You get. In fact, this breast milk is very strong. That is the reason why you find that a baby can pass out to just with drinking. It is very strong. If I finish, I'll end with the artificial passive immunity. With the artificial passive immunity, here you will see that we use already maybe antibodies. These antibodies are usually, you know what we do to get those antibodies? And usually this type of immunity is usually done to those people who are already weak. For example, person suffering from AIDS. The body is already weak fighting against AIDS, so it can now no longer fight against the immunizable diseases. What do? They will always, for example, use a horse because you believe animals were given that characteristic nature of healing by themselves. What we do, we shall get, for example, if it is measles, we inject the measles in the horse, and after injecting it in the horse, it will suffer from the measles and it produce antibodies that will help to fight the measles, and the remaining antibodies will be picked and taken to the laboratory and checked whether it is fine, and later those antibodies is what you call the serum. The serum will be brought and after checked properly, and those antibodies will be injected in that person to fight against that particular disease. So if I look at the advantages and disadvantages of all these, you will see that in the natural active immunity, the main advantage here is that it is longer lasting. Remember, a person has suffered, he has healed, antibodies are being stored. Therefore, the antibodies that are stored in excess are the ones that are used in future. So it is longer lasting. The disadvantage is that the person has to first suffer. Therefore, if it is disadvantageous. With the vaccines, still, what could be the major advantage is that it is longer lasting still. But the disadvantage is, the major disadvantage here is that this takes long to act. The body has to first produce the antibodies, then fight against the diseases. If I further continue with the natural passive immunity, that is the breast milk. The advantage is very simple. It is readily available and cheap, or is present. So it is this type of meter which is very cheap. And the disadvantage is with the breastfeeding, and a person can carry out cross infection. So take a scenario: a person is suffering from AIDS, and she has not taken her drugs, and she breastfeeds. The kid might get AIDS. So not might, has to get AIDS by all means. So with the already made antibodies, that is the official passive, you realize that here we have the advantage that it is fast acting. The moment you put it there, it will just look for where the microorganism is. But the disadvantage is it is short term. Once the antibodies are done, they are done. You just have to look for more and
protection should be.
Yeah, also that's what I was talking about. It is short lived. So if I continue, so with the functions of the lymphatic system. Now I hope we are all together with the defense and the immunity. But it's done under seromediated. We have what we call the fatty absorption. what you call fat absorption. With the fat absorption, you realize that with fat absorption here, it is done in the smaller intestines. So here you will see that as fat reach the smaller intestine, and they kept it there. So once the lymph comes to the small intestines, it will always mix with the fats, hence giving the lymphatic substance. And so doing, it has absorbed the fats. So after mixing with the lymph, the fats mixing with the lymph, it gives the lymphatic substance or color. Hope this is clear. If I continue, we also have what we call tissue drainage, and what we call fluid balance. So this is a very important aspect in the lymphatic system. How does the lymphatic system do this? You'll find that when we look at our heart, you realize that here, this is what we call the aorta that takes out blood. But by the time the aorta will take out blood, this blood will contain of a lot of liquids, of fluids. And therefore, it is very heavy, yet we have to transport it up to our last feet. What the lymphatic system will do, it will always drain those fluids into the lymphatic system. It will drain directly the fluids into the lymphatic system and let the blood continue to other body parts. You'll find that 21 liters are usually drained by the lymphatic system. But eventually, the pressure of the blood, it comes back to the vena cava from both the superior and inferior, the lymphatic system will bring back that fluid. And therefore, it has been able to drain, and also it has been able to balance. You can find that 20 liters can be brought back in blood. So the remaining one will be kept in the lymphatic vessels. That is how important lymphatic system is. Hope we are all there with the functions of the lymphatic system. We talked about the defense. We talked about the fat absorption, which is done in the small intestines. We also talked about
tissue drainage
and the fluid balance. It has been able to drain somewhat at the aorta, and then it has brought it back to the vena cava. Therefore, it has drained it and also balanced. So, after that, so it is still the top, still lymphatic system. Yeah, we should always cooperate so that we can try to maintain our mindset, keep on the business. So now I'm going to discuss for you what is composed of the lymphatic system. Composition of the lymphatic system. So now I'm going to look at the components of the lymphatic system. This is a usually set question where someone will always tell you to describe the components of the lymphatic system. I give 25 marks. Actually, you know, in our section, you see they can even give 40 or 30. So avoid failing such numbers because they can cause us to get retakes. So what we can do, the components of the lymphatic system. We see that the lymphatic system is composed of first what we call water. There is water in the lymphatic system. There is what we call ions. The ions. There is what we call the waste
materials.
We have what we call the hormones. We also have what we call the gases. We have cells. We talked about the T cells and the B cells found in the lymphatic system. Actually, this is composed of a lot of different things. So the lymphatic system is composed of a lot of different things. So as I discuss, does not mean that I'm giving the final thing. I'm just discussing to ease your work as you pass through. To the same as I told you to pass through at in the morning or at night, so that as I discuss, you can be able to pose some questions. Do we have some questions so far? We don't have questions. So I hope you are all online. I shared the link in the group so that you can invite people. You can keep on inviting people so that we can always keep you in touch. So with the components, we should start the lymph is composed of a lot of different things. And as I can see here, the lymphatic system, as we talked prior, and we said that it's the body's defense system. And these actually these are components of our lymph. These are the components of lymph. These are the components of the lymph. So lymph is composed of this. Of course, you will find that lymphatic system is more or less the same as the circulatory system. You get? So this is what is composed in the lymph. So if I also look at the composition of the lymphatic system, What is composed of the lymphatic system? The system itself. We have been looking at the composition of the lymph to create difference. Don't think that the composition of lymph is the same as the composition of the lymphatic system. As the system is composed of lymph itself, I am putting this here and this here. So that is where I facilitated what we call the difference. So with the components of the lymph, it is this. And there are very many other components. We have water, ions, waste. Those are components of lymph. Now, when we look at the composition of the lymphatic system as a system, it has lymph. It has also got what we call the lymph capillaries. It has also got what we call the lymph vessels. These ones help transport lymph. I'm going to look at one by one. We also have what we call the lymph nodes. We also have what we call the lymph ducts. We also have what we call the lymph tissues. And you must know that a tissue is a collection of different cells that perform similar functions. We also have what we call the lymph organs. With the lymph organs, we shall look at the spleen and the thymus gland. So, with these components, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, there are 7 components of the lymphatic system. If now I look at a component by component. So I've started with my lymph. So whenever you ask the question that what are the compositions of the lymphatic system, they are far different from the compositions of lymph. Lymph, it is the fluid transported by the lymphatic system. So if I look at lymph as first, lymph is a clear watery. Watery fluid found in the lymphatic system is a clear and watery. Actually, it is a clear watery fluid. It's more or less like water. So lymph is a clear watery fluid. The fluid is clear and watery. You must all appreciate that. You must all appreciate that with the lymph, we shall also we shall also be looking at what is composed of the lymph. As we looked at it prior or before, with the lymph, you will see that lymph is actually composed of different lymph is composed of different components, which are different from those that are composed in the lymphatic system. Lymph is composed of water, ions, waste materials, hormones, gases, cells. We can also have what we call enzymes. There are a lot of different things that are composed in the lymph. You get? So, after looking at the compositions of lymph, you will see that lymph is similar in composition with the plasma. So it is also someone is saying it's also composed of mineral salts. These mineral salts are very important. So these are the compositions of lymph. Let's try to comment by asking questions. So when we further continue, I want us to pass Nancy. Let's all work together so that we can pass Nancy. It is a simple course, very easy to pass if I told you in love with it. Now, allow me also look at the, after looking at the composition, you shall see that there is, here goes a statement that lymph is similar in a composition with the plasma. We shall start, our lymph is similar in a composition with the plasma. The lymph we have is similar in composition with the plasma. Lymph, this is the NB. Lymph is actually similar in composition. It's actually similar in composition with the plasma. But they are not the same. Quote me right, they are just similar in composition. What is composed in here? It is just the same that is composed here, but they have also got differences. So let us look at the differences between lymph and the plasma. You must start plasma is the composition of blood. So with the lymph, we shall see that lymph contains of what we call cells. Yet this lacks cells. You realize that in plasma there is no cells. So if I can give an example, if you go to the hospital, you get your blood sample and it is put in a test tube, and centrifugation will take place. When they centrifuge, the pale yellow color will appear up, and the pigment, red pigment, will step down plus the cells. Now, do you realize that the cells are found in the red pigment, actually are found in blood, not the plasma? You must be. So therefore, it is the sole reason as to why actually lymph, actually as to why plasma is less than the other part of the blood. If I continue, we shall see that plasma is contained of more proteins. This one has less
proteins.
And last that, these proteins are lost at what we call lymphocapillary. These less proteins. You must know that proteins are very important nutrients in the body. So far, I think if I can make a wrap up of the lymph, we say the lymph is a clear bodily fluid. We further said lymph is similar in composition with the plasma. And also we give the difference. It's just similar in composition, but not the same. Therefore, there are some differences that are created, and we see that lymph has got cells while plasma lacks cells. We see that there are less proteins in the lymph, while there are more proteins in the plasma. If you can also talk about the colors, this is pale
yellow.
Well, this is what?
It is a clear
water fluid. That is also another difference that can be created here. So We say it's a clear outer field, it is similar in composition with the plasma, not the same, they are not the same, they're just similar in composition. So the differences are here that are created. So the components of lymph, we talked about, they are different from the compositions of the lymphatic system. Lymph is composed of water, ions, hormones, enzymes, mineral salts, waste materials, cell debris. Those are those are things that are composed of the lymph. If I can further continue, now hope I'm done with the lymph as the first component. Lymph is now done. That is what is transported by the lymphatic system. So lymph is a done deal. Lymph is a done deal. Do we have some questions here? Do you have some questions? I want to see whether we have got questions here. I want to check for questions. So if no questions, I can continue. I'm seeing no questions here. I'm seeing no questions. Yeah, I'm seeing someone commenting about the network. Yeah, it is up to you to try and fight with that network because you have nothing to do. Actually, where I am, the network seems to be stable. Someone saying, bro, name the live to end which topic, subject and class. Okay, I'll be talking about that. I'm seeing that people are just commending the work we are doing, and that is very nice. Now I'm continuing to other component of the lymphatic system. That's what we call the info capillaries. Lymph capillaries. So generally we must also remember that as I was discussing for you blood capillaries, we said capillaries, it is a term that is used for exchange of materials, and it's the same thing here. It is the same thing here. At capillary is a site for exchange of materials. But the difference is that lymph capillaries are blind ended tubes. Are blind ended tubes that allow exchange of materials. They are blind ended. If this is our cell, these are blind-ended. It is blind-ended. This is what we call the info. It is a blind-ended tube. So this is our interstitial space covered with interstitial fluid, or what we call a tissue fluid. So these are blind-ended tubes. That is what we call the info capillaries. You will find that with the capillaries, they are similar to what you do, blood capillaries. These are similar to blood capillaries. They're just similar. But the only difference is that with the lymph capillaries lack what we call a basement membrane. Difference is they lack a basement membrane. The lymph capillaries lack a basement membrane, and it is advantageous. If you can look at the structure of a blood capillary, it's like this. These are the cells, endothelial cells. That is a basement membrane. A basement membrane made up of what you call sonosoids. You see that as the blood comes, you have to first diffuse through this basement membrane, then it reaches the interior cells. And when it reaches the interior cells, then it diffuses again into the cell. But with the lymph capillaries, this membrane is not there. Therefore, once lymph comes, it will just reach the cell directly. Therefore, the major advantage over lymph capillaries lacking in this membrane is very simple. The first advantage is it increases permeability. It increases permeability. Of different actually materials that are brought. You see that the proteins this time will be able to enter the cell easily. Because it has to diffuse through the semi-permeable basement membrane, it will just reach the cell. Mm-hmm. The other advantage, these cells tend to grow or to be aligned in a cup-shaped format. Therefore, they form valves that are very, very important. These valves help to prevent the backflow of lymph. We must all appreciate that lymph in the lymphatic system, we lack what we call a pump. Unlike the bloody, actually in the circulatory system, where we have, and that is the cardiovascular system, if CV, yes, we have what we call a pump, the pump called the heart. But here, I'll talk about the mechanisms through which lymph is transported. So these are advantages of lymph capillaries lacking a basement membrane. If I can summarize, I said a lymph capillary is a blind-ended tube. It is similar in composition with blood capillaries, but the only difference is lymph capillaries lack a basement membrane, which is advantageous in its own way. It increases permeability, and the cells tend to grow in a cup-shaped form. For acting as valves, the valves to enter the backflow of lymph. So, if I further continue, you will see that these ones are made up of what we call squamous epithelial tissue. Squamous epithelial tissue. With the squamous epithelial tissue, this is made up of flatty cells. These flat cells help to give a smooth flow of lymph, help to give a smooth flow of lymph through capillaries. And therefore, with this smooth flow, we shall start, lymph will be able to pass through these capillaries. Let me stop capillaries at that, and I also call it a downimmune. So, I want you to comment questions. I am also using my phone here to look at if we have got questions here. So far, I'm not seeing any question. I'm not seeing questions. So, but I'm waiting for them. I'll be waiting for the questions either in group or anyway. Yeah. So after looking at our lymph has reached the lymph capillaries and the protein, actually and the various proteins that we saw that they are composed in the lymph capillary have been now lost. They have been lost at these capillaries. They will have diffused to the cell, and now lymph will be free of the proteins. So, if I can continue, what has brought the lymph to reach the capillaries are what we call lymph vessels. And NB, before I start, NB, when you combine a lymph capillary and a lymph capillary, it will give us a lymph vessel. Therefore, a combination of lymph capillaries and lymph capillary give us a lymph vessel. If I have a lymph vessel, you will see that if this is our first capillary, this is another capillary. So when we come together and bring these together, you see that we formed what we call lymph vessels. So when someone sets an objective and says the composition of lymph gives us A, vessels B, lymph tissues, lymph nodes. So the answer is what you call lymph vessels. And that statement brings us to what we call lymph vessels. Lymph vessels. Mm-hmm. So lymph vessels are tubes that transport lymph together. Are we there? Are tubes that transport lymph. Lymph vessels are similar to blood vessels. They also have three layers. Like in the blood vessels, which is made up of the tunica adventitia, tunica media, and the tunica intima. So you'll see that also here we have got three layers, where the outer layer is made up of fibrous connecting tissue. And you must also appreciate that fibrous connecting tissue is made up of less cells and more fibers. This helps to give it more strength to protect the underlying surfaces. Yeah. So the middle layer is made up of smooth and elastic what? Muscles. These muscles help in stretching and contraction of a lymph vessel in the case lymph is being transported through it. The last layer, the inner layer, is made up of squamous epithelial tissue. And I said with the squamous epithelial tissue, it is made up of what you call flatty cells. These flat cells give that medium, which is very smooth for movement of lymph. Yeah, you must all appreciate that lymph vessel is also made up of three layers, the outer, the middle, and the inner. Outer being made up of fibrous connecting tissue, the middle being made up of smooth and elastic tissue, squamous with the for the inner layer. So I'll stop like this with the vessels. Remember the first NB introduced us to the lymph vessels. It was saying a combination of lymph capillaries gave us lymph vessels. But now, as the another NB here, that will introduce us to another thing. As lymph vessels come together, they enlarge to form lymph ducts. So as this is a vessel coming from up, and this one, as they come together, they tend to enlarge and form ducts. So this is what we call a duct. Are we together? This is what we call a duct. So this introduces me to what we call lymph ducts. What are lymph ducts? Lymph ducts are areas where lymph is drained in the lymphatic system. It is that where lymph is powered for some time before it is continues in its journey. Are areas where lymph is drained. Roughly, we are looking at what we call lymph drainage. And in the human body, we have two major ducts. Two ducts. Major ducts. The first one is what we call the thoracic. The thoracic duct. And the other what we call the right lymphatic duct. So, with these two, we can discuss more about drainage. When lymph is being transported, where is it forward? If I start with the first, which is called the thoracic duct. So, this duct, it has a length of 40 centimeters. Actually, it is located in the thoracic cavity. That is, the thoracic cavity runs from the upper trunk of the neck to the diaphragm. So it is 40 centimeters long, and it runs from what we call the chitina cori. It runs from what we call the runs from some part in the thoracic cavity. The thoracic cavity, and this part is called the chitina chari to around the lumbar. Actually, it's around the sternum. That is where the thoracic duct runs from. But it is 40 centimeters. So, it's actually located, it twists around what you call the collar bone. So, you look at this duct, you wonder, 40 centimeters, how can they be? It will just twist around this collar bone on the left-hand side. That is around the chitina chari to around the midi sternum. By the time it reaches here, you'll see that it will be 40 centimeters. And when you look at the diagram of the lymphatic system, I don't know whether they can try to bring the camera closer, but I can show you something. Is it close? So you will see that the thoracic duct we are talking about is located here on this left side, and I'm showing the lymphatic system. It is showing all the components we talked about, the ducts, the vessels, the bone marrow, and whatever. This is what you call the lymphatic system. Hope you can see something here. It is actually these dark lines. Not vessels, they are called ducts. We only have two major ducts. We have that, and we also have what we call the right lymphatic duct. It is this side on the right side of the collarbone. Are we together? So I can continue. So hope I've discussed about the thoracic duct. But if I can further continue, what areas does the thoracic duct drain? Which areas power their lymph in this? Power their lymph in the thoracic duct? We shall see that there is the pelvic region and its organs. And the organs. The pelvic region runs from around the middle umbilicus, in between the umbilicus and the pubic bone, to the lower parts. All those areas power their lymph in the thoracic duct. We have what's called the abdominal regions. They also power their lymph in the thoracic duct. Then we can bring in other term called the left. So because it's located on the left, we shall say that the left neck is powering its lymph in this thoracic duct. The left thorax. The left head is also all the lymph in this duct. Are we together? So if I continue with the other right lymphatic duct, I believe all of us have understood what you call the thoracic duct. It is 40 centimeters long. It's located in the thoracic cavity. on around the midi clavicle, actually around the collarbone or the clavicle bone. So it is running from the part called the chitina chiari to around the midi sternum. The sternum is this bone. So if I continue with the right lymphatic duct, it is just the opposite of what I've discussed here. With the right lymphatic duct, the right lymphatic duct, you will see, and actually it is better as we discuss it, not busy with other businesses so that you can get me. Actually, even those who are not online will be able to come and watch this video anytime. With the right lymphatic duct, this is 1 centimeter long. Imagine this is just 1 centimeter long. Okay, near the collarbone of the right thorax. Well, the right thorax. What areas power the lymph in this duct? You will see that we have the right neck, because it's just the opposite of what we have. The right thorax. The right head. And many other parts also are there lymph in this right thoracic duct. Call it a discussion. I'm done with the ducts. These are also a done deal. So now here we shall look at what we call the lymph nodes. This is a very important aspect in the lymphatic system. It is called lymph nodes. Lymph nodes. You find that these lymph nodes are usually found at the end of the lymph vessels. As a vessel comes at its end, you find that a bean-like shaped structure, and it will continue. How does the lymph node look like? Actually, a lymph node is an area where phagocytosis takes place in the lymphatic system. It is a site for destruction of microorganisms. Yeah, when someone talks about lymph nodes, this is an area which is protected by what we call a capsule. Which capsule is actually made up of what we call fibrous connecting tissue. You see that almost all areas and all parts in the body are protected by the fibrous connecting tissue, because it is made up of more fibers and less cells. It is made up of fibrous connecting tissues. It is further still also made up of two arteries called the afferent vessels. Are we together? Afferent vessels. And the vein, one vein called the efferent vessels. Are we there? Yeah. If we further continue, you will find that in between the lymph node, there are some other vessels that transport lymph pass through the node. So those are what we call the trabeculae. These trabeculae are very important in transporting lymph within the node. So we also have a connecting tissue found inside the node called reticular stop lymphoid connecting tissue. And this tissue you must all appreciate that it is composed of what we call macrophages, which macrophages help in destruction of microorganisms. So it is this site where there is killing of microorganisms. You will see that inside still in the lymph node, we shall see that cell division will take place of T cells. Therefore, it is a site for multiplication of T cells. It is a site for multiplication of T cells. This is a site for multiplication of T cells. It is an important site where the T cells will multiply. So after understanding the components of a lymph node, now who cannot draw that? So let us look at the structure. The structure of a lymph node. So with this diagram, I want to show you. Let the camera be sent near the book so that I can show you how a lymph node looks like. It is this. This is how it looks like. It is very simple. This is how it looks like. But then I will also try to draw it for you, and you see how simple it can be. So remember, we said a lymph node is a bean-shaped organ. It's a bean-shaped structure where phagocytosis takes place in the lymphatic system. As you draw this, you will first of all draw the shape of the bean. After that, we talked of the two arteries called the afferent vessels. This is what you call the afferent. Also talk about what you call the efferent vessels. This concave shape of the efferent vessel is what we call the helium. And we also talked about the capsule that protects the lymph node from damage. This is what we call the capsule. With you knowing the parts what and their uses, then it is very easier for you to come up with this drawing. So we talked of the vessels that transport lymph within the lymph node. Those are what we call the trabeculum. So this is what we call the trabeculum. It depends on the area you come from, that is how you can pronounce this. So you will find that someone can tell you to draw and also show a flow of lymph. Lymph will come like this from the arteries, pass through the trabeculum, then it gets out of the efferent vessel. But as it gets out, inside here, we have a reticular connecting tissue. This reticular connecting tissue will help. This is what we call the reticular stroke lymphoid, which contains of microphages that will help to call out phagocytosis. Someone can pose the question and say, explain phagocytosis and the lymph nodes. It is very simple. I explained it with the cell-mediated type of unit. We shall see that the lymphocytes will produce for us what we call the T cells. These T cells stimulate the production of beta cells. The beta cells help us in production of what we call the antibodies. And now when the microorganism has been transported by the lymph, as microorganisms have been transported by the lymph to the lymph node, they will be killed from here and then taken out. Roughly, you will see that the other function of lymph is the transportation of microorganism, transportation of nutrients,
Mm-hmm. Transportation of fats. Those are some of the functions of lymph, which I think are very simple. So with you understanding the structure of a lymph node, I think I can also call it a done deal. So now also lymph nodes are done. There's something here not talking of a tissue. A tissue. We are going to talk about that also. And the only tissue we have two tissues in the body. The tissue is a group of similar cells performing similar functions. So the tissue we have here is what we call the bony marrow. The bony marrow. And what we call the malt. The malt, the mucosa associated in the tissue. And we talk about both. We have already talked about the roof. Virtually the bony marrow, as it helps us to produce for us lymphocytes. Now let me try to look at the lymph organs. Lymph organs. So majorly here we're going to look at two organs. That is what we call the spleen and the thymus. Thymus gland. The other part you always see in a book is what we call the malt. So, but then this malt, I hope you are sending in comments. As I finish, I want to look at those questions and I answer them. With the malt, it is not a what? It's not an organ. This is not an organ. I will discuss for you why. So let us first do some. Okay. How do we get these organs and how do we come up with them? So remember, we have our cells here, and once our cells are in a group, they give us what we call a tissue. These are our cells. Once they are enclosed, they give us what we call a tissue. And once the capsule is put around them, it gives us an organ. So the remaining cells that are put in a group and that do not have a capsule are what we call the tissues, the malt, the mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. These are the malt. We shall discuss them. Let me start with the spleen. With the spleen, this is a site which is very important in filtering or destructing microorganisms that surface in it. Blood. It is in charge of killing microorganisms that surface in blood. Any microorganism that is surfaces in blood is killed by the spleen. So the spleen is located in the left hypochondriac region. The left hypochondriac region. So remember, the stomach is divided into three regions. The first part is what we call the hypochondriac region. The second part is what we call the lumbar region. Yeah. Then the lower part is called what we call the iliac. It's called the iliac region. Yeah. So this is the right side, this is the left side. So to me, my right is your left. You must know that. So it is located in the left hypochondriac. So the spleen is here. It is oval and the purple in color. It is oval shaped, it runs as it goes down, and the purple in color. And the purple in color. So when I look at the structure of a spleen, let me get it for you here before we draw it. So this is the structure of the spleen. This is how it looks like. You see that the spleen lacks what you call an efferent vessels. It's only composed of afferent vessels. And how do they work? How do they work? Remember, we say it is oval shaped. It's oval shape.
So one of the affirmative, remember that's the affirmative, is there, and the other one is here.
So as blood comes from the liver here, it will be transported into the spleen to be cleaned. So you see that the lymph will come, actually the blood will come and enter here. Remember, this spleen is also protected by what you call the capsule. And what you call the capsule. All together. So, and once it enters here, there are also trabeculae. These are inner vessels that transport lymph. And there is what you call the lymphoid connecting the tissue. This is more or less the same like the lymph node. It has also got what you call the splenic pulp. This splenic pulp are two in number. It's what we call the white and the red splenic pulp. These are very important aspects. Very, very important aspects that are responsible in cleaning the blood. This is how it is done. Blood will come, enter into the trabeculum, and it is cleaned by this tissue. Then it will go out. Are we together? That is how the spleen looks like. So allow me look at the major functions of the spleen. What could be the major function of the spleen? The first function is what you call
cytosis.
This is where cells and microorganisms are engulfed and killed. Is what we call the erythropoiesis. The erythropoiesis, this is the formation of red blood cells. And we must all appreciate that this erythropoiesis takes place in different stages. Roughly, I can also give you some clue about the erythropoiesis, how red blood cells formed. So, this is how it goes. Under erythropoiesis, you will see that it starts from what we call a pluripotent stem cell. That will always help. That will always help in the formation of two stages. This is what we call the proerythroblasts and the erythroblasts. Under those two stages, we will see that we have seven activities taking place. The first one is iron accumulation. There is cell division, production of hemoglobin. There is a color change. There is also we have talked so far of four stages. There is also what you call the red blood cell will always lose its nucleus, hence getting a bifurcated shape. So you know that red blood cells have no nucleus. Still, we shall also have red blood cell losing its nucleus. Are we together? Those are the activities that take place, and it will take us to the mature site or the reticulocytes. From the reticulocytes, we shall go to what we call the erythrocytes, and that is the last stage of formation of red blood cells. So it's also helping in what we call blood storage. How is this one seen? For example, once the blood is in excess in the body, it is stored in the spleen. So you see that it is stored in the spleen that. In case of hemorrhage or internal bleeding, this blood will come and play a bigger part. You get? All together there, we say lymphocytosis, erythropoiesis. We also looked at blood storage. This is also important in defense and immunity. Defense and this helps in the defense and immunity. By the process I told you, by help of the cell mediated type of immunity. How there? Those are the functions of the spleen. So then you look at the other organ, which is called the thymus. The thymus gland here. This thymus gland is here. Actually, the thymus gland is made up of two lobes, and those two lobes are joined by a loose connecting tissue or a regular connecting tissue. It grew behind, this is behind the sternum, this is the sternum, the middle bone separating ribs. This is where it is. It is like this. This is the lobe. You know, as you looked at the compound lobe, the ribs, they have a common start, but they later separate. This is how the thymus also grew.
It is this green part you can see separates this green area. This is the area you can see here. It is also located in the thoracic cavity, but it is behind the sternum. So,
this is a very important part, which helps in also phagocytosis. It also helps in phagocytosis and also formation of thymosin hormone. This hormone usually helps in the development of the T cells. It's that hormone that will be transported to the lymph node and helps in the stimulation of the cell division of T cells. So its major function is produce for us thymosin hormone and also defense and immunity, then phagocytosis. Has got three major functions. That's what I can talk about the thymus gland. So if I'm to leave a clue or a question, I want you to go and look at the boundaries. When someone says explain the boundaries using the anatomical terms, superiorly, inferiorly, anteriorly, laterally, what organs bound it, what areas bound the following organs. This is the spleen. That means superiorly we have what called the diaphragm. What called the diaphragm? If you have the large intestines down, you look at that part. So and now we also talk about the mucosa associated with mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. Mucosa. It is a tissue. Mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. This is not an organ, it is just a tissue. And it is seen in two ways. We have the tonsils and what you call the Peyer's patch. These are the two tissues found in the lymphatic system. It is not an organ, it is just a tissue because it is not covered in the capsule. So, here, the tonsils are located here in between our throat. This one helps to fight microorganisms that would cross the throat. The tonsils, the Peyer's patch are located in the smaller intestines, to fight microorganisms, smaller intestines. So any defect on the tonsils will always lead to what you call the tonsillitis. The tonsillitis, there's much tonsillitis. Call them tonsillitis, that is called tonsillitis. So that is when they enlarge, and such that when you eat food, you see that you are taking in a larger substance. Yes, you have already crushed it, already carried out mechanical digestion. So that is what you call the tonsils. Also have what you call the Peyer's patch. Peyer's patch found in the small intestine. So when a person talks about the mucosa associated tissue, that is a tissue that is exposed to the external environment. It's divided into groups, at the tonsils and the Peyer's patch. Areas that are connected to the external environment, for example, the digestive system, what we eat comes from out. The urinary system is exposed to the external environment. The upper tract of a human person is also exposed to the external environment. Hope you have all got through with that part. I'm going to complete the topic with looking at the defects. Defects. The defects of the lymphatic system. What diseases? Defects stop these orders. Here, I will start with the tonsillitis. the tonsillitis. These ones are the ones I talked of for enlargement of the tonsils. We lead to tonsillitis. They have what we call the splenomegaly. Splenomegaly. This is the enlargement of the spleen. In a case a microorganism fails to be engulfed and killed, it always runs to the caps of the spleen and therefore causing an impact by enlarging it. Have what we call the splenomegaly. Also what you call the lymph tumors. It can be and a swelling that can happen in a lymph vessel, which can actually lead to blockage of lymph vessel. And in so doing, the lymph vessel will burst, hence pouring water in space, causing what you call the another term called the edema. Edema is the concentration of water in the space, the body space. It is very bad, and this usually comes after a tumor has happened. There is also what you call, there are a lot of disorders. There are also what you call the thyroid, which is what you call the enlargement of the node, which is also called lymphomasy. You can look for other disorders. Those are some of the few I can give at a time, and because of time, and we need to do other business. That is how I've tried to pass through the system, and I want us to end with the prayer. And before the prayer, I would like to thank a person on the camera, to thank an area also in part of the discussion. Thank people who helped me to improvise so that we can cut out the discussion. Also thank the persons who sent the data. With them we shall be able to catch up. So whenever we shall be having our data, we shall be able to continue the discussions. I believe we are done with the lymphatic system. I've given actually almost 30%. The 30% is yours. I expect to find questions in group. I'm going to share the link. Those who wish can go and look through this part. And I also commend you to continue getting online as we discuss. Things will be moving on. For any question, you can also call me personally. My number is 0750982972. You can call me or WhatsApp me. We shall be passing through anything. Hopefully, we shall be discussing what we could do in the group. What can we do next? Which topic shall we be discussing? Let us have anatomy thrice a week. We also have some microbiology. We also have some foundation a day in a week. So the Saturday is for pressing as in our culture in Raka. I also want to thank those people coming from Itiana. Also want to thank them. They have also been live trying to go through what we are discussing. Yes, Fime, thank you for organizing them. I want to thank a lot of different people like us. Everyone who has been able to surface in the discussion, let us end the prayer. Lord, our Father, thank you for this day. Thank you that we are still living. We thank you that you give us life, that we can continue with the revision daily. We know that with your presence, nothing is impossible. With your presence, nothing can't happen. Stay tuned. Thank you for listening. Bye-bye.